Good morning and welcome. We're glad that you're here, whether you're here in person or here online. We're glad to have you here this morning to focus your attention on our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. I invite you to stand with me for our call to worship. Some weeks seem a bit more challenging than others, don't they? There's a lot going on in the world right now. But we focus our attention on a God who works wonders. I was drawn to Psalm 77, where it says, "Your way, O God, is holy. What God is great like our God? You are the God who works wonders." Let's pray. Father, we focus on you this morning. We focus on who you are, on your character, on your power, on your knowledge, on your love, on your wisdom. And Lord, we know that we are safe and secure in you. So Lord, this morning we lift up our praises and our worship to you, and we ask that you visit us now in this time and warm every heart. We pray that in your name. Amen.
Amen. Let's join together and singing praises to our God today. Light of the world, you step down into darkness. Open my eyes, let me see beauty that made this heart adore you, hope of a life spent with you. So here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. King of all days, oh so highly exalted, glorious in heaven above. Humbly you came to the earth you created, all for love's sake became poor. So here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. Yeah, here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. And I'll never know how much it costs to see my sin upon that cross. I'll never know how much it costs to see my sin upon that cross. I'll never know how much it costs see my sin upon that cross. So here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. Here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether Altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. We stand and lift up our hands. For the joy of the Lord is our strength. We bow down and worship Him now. How great, how awesome is He. Together we see. Everyone see. Holy is the Lord God Almighty. Down and worship Him now. How great, how awesome is He. Together we see. Everyone see. Holy is the Lord God Almighty. The earth is filled with His glory. The Lord's renown, it is rising up all around. It's the anthem of the Lord's renown. It is rising up all around. It's the anthem of the Lord's renown. It is rising up all around. It's the anthem of the Lord's renown. Together we sing. Everyone sing. Holy is the Lord God Almighty. The earth is filled with His glory. Holy is the Lord God Almighty. The earth is filled with His glory. Holy is the Lord God Almighty. The earth is filled with His glory. Holy is the Lord God Almighty. The earth is filled with His glory. The earth is filled with His glory. The earth. You are not a God created by human hands. You are not a God dependent on any mortal man. You are not a God in need of anything we can give by your plan. That's just the way it is. You are God alone from before time began. You were on your throne. You are God alone. And right now, in the good times and bad, you are on your throne. You are God alone. You're the only God whose power none can contend. You're the only God whose name and praise will never end. You're the only God who's worthy of everything we can give. You are God, that's just the way it is. You are God alone, from before time began. You were on your throne, you are God alone. And right now, in the good times and bad, you are on your throne, you are God alone, you are God alone. From before time began, you're unstoppable, that's what you are. You're unchangeable, you're unshakable, you're unstoppable, that's what you are. You're unchangeable, unshakable, unstoppable, that's what you are. You're unchangeable, you're unshakable, you're unstoppable, that's what you are. You are God alone, from before time began, you were on your throne. You are God alone, and right now, in the good times and bad, you are on. Times and bad, you are on your throne, you are God alone. You are God alone. I'm not God. We're so grateful for that. No one in this place is God except for you, but you are in this place. We are so grateful that you are our God. You've always been God from before time began. In the good times and bad, Lord, you are always on your throne and nothing will ever change that. Thank you for that, Lord. Thank you that you are unchangeable, unshakable, unstoppable. Thank you for being all you are, Lord. We worship you today. In the name of Jesus, amen. I invite you all to sit down, but if the children want to come on up, Kevin's got a message for you today.
Yeah, don't look at all those kids right over there. My, I should sit on this side, right? Now you're looking. Okay. You guys ever run like a long time, like in a race, or maybe ride a bike for a long, long bike ride, or maybe go swimming in the water for a long time, or maybe go to camp all week and it's a long, long time and you're kind of exhausted and you want to kind of give up? What kind of encouragement do you need to keep going? You need somebody to come alongside and say, hey, you can do this, let's keep going, right? Or way to go, good job, that's encouragement, right? Anybody here going to be 9 soon? Are you 8 now? You sure? Anybody over there 9 years old? Oh, my. Do you have a world record in anything? Yes. I don't want to know. Okay, so there was a 9-year-old named James Savage. James Savage lived out in California, and he wanted to make a world record. Out in California, there's this island out in the middle of the bay off of San Francisco. It's about a little more than a mile away from the coast of San Francisco, coast of California. And people built a prison on this little island called Alcatraz. And they sent the meanest, toughest criminals out there, out in the middle of the choppy, cold, shark-filled waters. Because they thought, if anybody broke out of this prison, they'd be crazy to try to swim on this cold and wavy and sharky water to get back to California. So anyway, they closed the prison a while ago, so it's not open for business. But swimmers have still made the decision to hop off of San Francisco at the aquatic park and swim in the cold and wavy and sharky water all the way to Alcatraz. That is like, okay, pretend that Madison Avenue out here is water that's cold and wavy and with sharks. And you swam all the way from church, all the way just past the old Quick Trip. Could you swim that? And then, okay, let's turn around and swim all the way back in the cold and wavy and sharky waters. 9-year-old James Savage decided he wanted to be the youngest person ever to swim that. So let's hear what happened.
A boy from the Central Valley is not just studying history, he is making history.
Oh, look at this guy.
Love him.
9-year-old James Savage gave his family and friends plenty to cheer about in San Francisco yesterday. James is now the youngest person to make that treacherous swim out to Alcatraz and back to San Francisco's aquatic park.
I thought it was going to be easy at first, but then after I got out there, the tide was pushing me all around. I was about to quit, but then I kept on going.
You hear what he said? He wanted to give up because the tide was pushing against him and it was cold and he was already tired and he wanted to, but he kept going. Wonder what encouraged him. You see the first part where that lady picked him up. He could barely raise his arms and got out of the water after swimming, and she picked him up and hugged him. Guess who that was? His mommy. Is she a source of encouragement? To give him courage, to give him strength. Let's see what she had to say about this.
It's crazy. He's crazy, but we're very proud of him.
He's crazy. But we'll let him stick around. Was that very encouraging? She loves James, and she hugged him and stuff, but she thinks he's kind of wacky. Anyway. So maybe she wasn't the best encourager. What about Dad? You know, there were a couple of people in kayaks sitting there comfortably, rowing as James was swimming against the current, and it was cold, and they were watching out for sharks and everything. So they were going right along. And one of them was his dad rowing along with James swimming. And guess what? Well, let's just see what he did.
Right, James.
I'm proud of him too. His dad promised him $100 if he made the swim. When James started getting a little tired yesterday, Dad upped the ante to $200, and that apparently worked. James began swimming when he was 4.
That's a boy.
Dad paid him. He said, James, I'm going to give you $100 if you can swim there. And then James got tired and he wanted to give up, and Dad said, okay, I'll give you $200 if you can swim. And he did it. Is that the best kind of encouragement? It kind of kept him going. Yeah, they'd do it for $200. There was another reporter that said, I wouldn't do it for $1 million. But there are different kinds of encouragement. But that doesn't last a long, long time. I bet James has spent that money, right? Since then, since he made that swim. God gives a special kind of encouragement. It's a forever encouragement. Listen to this verse from Paul in 2 Thessalonians. It says, "The Lord Jesus and God our Father loved us and by his grace gave us not just encouragement, but eternal encouragement, forever encouragement, and good hope." So we can encourage other people, right, and come alongside and say, attaboy, you can do this, keep going, you're only four, okay. So, but that's one way to encourage. God gives a forever, eternal encouragement that lasts forever. So let's thank him. God, we thank you that you said that whoever believes, you will save them. They will not see death, and you will give them eternal, everlasting, encouraging life. And we thank you for that in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you, guys.
Thank you, Kevin. That was a great message. And speaking of world records, we are thrilled to have our intermediate campers here this morning. I am especially blessed by the, yeah. I am especially blessed by them because you guys sing really good and really loud. Thank you. It was nice sitting in front of you. I was blessed by that. And there's a couple of things I want to tell you about for today and for this upcoming season. First of all, we are celebrating communion today during the service. It will be at the end after the sermon. So if you have not yet gotten one of your cups, either you can go and get it now, or I believe Janet will come up the center aisle with cups at the appropriate time. And if you are at home, now would be the time to get your bread and juice. For anyone who is a believer is welcome to join us in that communion time together. Second announcement, we have a golf outing coming up. We got a lot of social stuff coming up. August 28th, that's at Riverside Golf Course in Janesville. If you are a golfer or a wannabe golfer, this would be a thing to sign up for. It'll be a good time. There's some food involved, and Rich Galagos is your connection, and so there are details in your bulletin or in the Friday update. Also coming up in September, but it's time to sign up now, is a Brewers game. Who doesn't want to go see a Brewers game? Yeah. okay, that was a bad thing. I did see a few hands on that. For those of you who would like to go to a Brewers game, there's an opportunity to go. Matt Uglum is your contact on that. That's Saturday, September 10th. There's a sign-up and more information in the Welcome Center, in the bulletin, and in the Friday update. And with that, it's time for our ever-popular camp slideshow.
I've been trying to find a better way that I can explain it. I met somebody and they love me and it's blowing my mind. 'Cause they know all the places that I've been, but they stay with me knowing who I am. You understand it, won't you feel it, why it's hard to define? 'Cause it's better than sunshine in a summertime blue sky. The best day of your whole life is being born for the second time. It's a freedom, it's a healing, sweeter than you'll ever find. And it's better than sunshine, it's better than sunshine. You got the doubt in your eyes, kinda easy to see it. Had you a couple rough years where nothing went right. So I know, yeah, I know what you're thinking. Ain't a person on earth that could change it. But this ain't something from earth, this is something divine.
and it's better than sunshine in a summertime blue sky. The best day of your whole life is being born for the second time. It's a freedom, it's a healing, sweeter than you'll ever find, and it's better than sunshine. It's better than sunshine. My Savior is better. My Jesus is better. His love is forever. It's forever. My Savior is better. My Jesus is better. His love is forever. It's forever.
All right, what a great slideshow. Yeah, and there must be a million stories behind those pictures. Yeah, but we'll save those for later. Speaking of stories, I want to tell a few stories today, because I've been told we're not allowed to throw eggs inside the sanctuary. Sorry, Dylan. We're going to have to cut that out for this week. So a story... I want to tell a story about our son, Luke. He's not here this week. It's a great time to tell a story. And so Luke headed to Israel 3 weeks ago, and I was his travel agent. I'm a poor excuse of a travel agent. So I texted him because I wanted to see how things went. And his text back was, there were some hiccups, but I made it, mostly. I want to tell you about the hiccups because it's an interesting story. So this is not Luke's first foray with security. He has flown without a driver's license before. That's an interesting story in and of itself. But in this story, Luke left in the morning. It was a busy morning, so he didn't have a lot of time to get breakfast and things, so he grabbed a couple snacks and he left. Got on the bus in Janesville, went down to O'Hare, and then made his flight to Newark. And in Chicago, his plan was he was going to get his lunch or supper or breakfast or all three. But he's related to his father, and the food was really expensive. And he thought, I'll wait. I'll get this later. And then he got to Newark, and it turns out his flight was 2 hours earlier than it was supposed to be. Who gets early flights? Anyway, so he got there. It was 2 hours early, so he rushed into security, got in line, and this is international security, and they're asking him very pointed questions about why would a computer science major from Chicago be going for an archaeological dig in Israel. They're very concerned. And Luke was quite concerned about being hungry and thirsty. He said at this point, the room started getting kind of cloudy, sort of gray, sort of like coming in around him. And next thing he knew, he was on the floor. Fortunately, he's wearing a backpack, so he didn't smack his head on the floor. That would have been a better story. But So at this point, the encouraging dad said, I'll give you $100 if you get out of this. So, so Luke said he opened his eyes, and there were a significant number of very nice policemen with very large guns over top of him. Hiccup, right? Hiccup. He didn't tell his mother about this until well after this all this happened. And so what happened at this point was the nice policeman told him, you need to get up. They gave him supper. They gave him plenty to drink. They rushed him through the handicap accessible security with absolutely no line so he could make it to his flight on time. There are times in life in which we face difficult situations in which we desperately need someone to encourage us by saying, get up. But it doesn't stop with words, in which they come alongside us, they nourish us, they walk alongside us and get us to the destination. This morning, we're going to take a look at 3 John again. Last week, we thought about how these words are encouraging to keep going in what you are already doing and keep going with that. This week, we're going to listen for how this letter is encouraging to stand up to oppose what's wrong. So Kevin's going to read for us again. And again, I hope that this week we listen for the words of John, an older man who's speaking from experience these encouraging words. So let's listen to this encouragement.
The elder to the beloved Gaius, whom I love in truth. Beloved, I pray that all may go well with you and that you may be in good health as it goes well with your soul. For I rejoiced greatly when the brothers came and testified to your truth, as indeed you are walking in the truth. I have no greater joy than to hear that my children are walking in the truth. Beloved, it is a faithful thing you do in all your efforts for these brothers, strangers as they are, who testified to your love before the church. You will do well to send them on their journey in a manner worthy of God. For they have gone out for the sake of the name, accepting nothing from the Gentiles. Therefore, we ought to support people like these, that we may be fellow workers for the truth. I have written something to the church, but Diotrephes, who likes to put himself first, does not acknowledge our authority. So if I come, I will bring up what he is doing, talking wicked nonsense about us. And not content with that, he refuses to welcome the brothers and also stops those who want to and puts them out of the church. Beloved, do not imitate evil, but imitate good. Whoever does good is from God. Whoever does evil has not seen God. Demetrius has received a good testimony from everyone and from the truth itself. We also add our testimony, and you know that our testimony is true. I had much to write to you, but I would rather not write with pen and ink. I hope to see you soon, and we will talk face to face. Peace be to you. The friends greet you. Greet the friends, each by name.
Thank you, Kevin. For us to be encouraged, there's a need to listen and not just speak. And that comes across here. And first, there's words of encouragement to soak in to keep going, what we talked about last week, in which Gaius is encouraged to keep going with loving people and being hospitable, hosting people. But he's also encouraged to be sending. Keep sending those missionaries out. Keep supporting people. Keep working as fellow workers. This week, what we're going to look at is the part of the story in which John walks into some uncomfortable territory. He starts talking about what's wrong, the problem that needs to be addressed, to stand up and oppose something. Now, there's 3 key people that we're going to look at this week, that we're going to walk through. First is Diotrephes. He's the bad guy of the story. There's Gaius. He's a good guy. And then John, the author. Now, let's walk through this. What we're going to see is Diotrephes is to recognize what's wrong with me. That's me for all of us, not just all of you focusing on what's wrong with me, but okay, all right, you're not going to write a list for me. And then think about what's wrong with you, with Gaius, and then how to communicate what's wrong with John's words. So let's walk through this. Let's start with diatriphes, in which I think what we usually start with is, who does this guy remind me of, right? They come up with names of, oh, yeah, this just like this guy. Let's start assuming this is us. Let's assume that once in a while we sin, maybe, perhaps, some of us. I'm just going to make that assumption, that a few have sinned. Let's assume that these words might be for some introspection. So let's think about who Diotrephes is. This is his only mention in the Bible. Oh, happy times to get your name listed here, right? And I love how this is worded. Diotrephes, who likes to put himself first. Boy, I wish my name could be next to that in the Bible, right? His mama must have been so proud. Yeah, my Diotrephes, he knows how to act like he's number one. That's my boy, right? I mean, this is not a great thing. What John says is, Diotrephes thinks he knows what's best. He has no use for authority. What John says is, he does not acknowledge our authority. An apostle's authority he rejects because he knows better. Is this first century or 21st century, right? In which we know better than anybody else. Some introspection here. The story goes on. It's important to notice that John isn't concerned about some sort of heresy. He doesn't say, and that Diotrephes, he is into some sort of strange theology. What he says is he's thwarting God's work. Did you notice there's three specific things that he lists here? One is talking wicked nonsense. That takes me back to the 90s, right? Wicked nonsense. Oh, yeah. The 90s is a long time. Don't go back to the 90s. It wasn't good. Talking wicked nonsense. That's gossip, right? He's gossiping about the good guys. The other thing in the list, he refuses to welcome the brothers. He doesn't practice hospitality. He stops those who want to and puts them out of the church. He is thwarting God's work. It's not a theology issue. There's a sin issue, not necessarily a blatant moral issue. I mean, gossiping is wrong, but what he's doing is he's thwarting God's work. And John says, this is a big deal. Now, it's easy to kind of jump to thinking, I wouldn't be that guy, right? None of us want to think that we'd be the bad guy of the story. It's in our nature to end up in this role. And I want to do this by telling another story. The story of the Man Gulch wildfire. I was talking with Caleb about this before the service. It's really a fascinating story, and it is a tragedy. I'll give you that right up front. It's a tragedy, and we're going to move it towards a shared tragedy of what we can learn from. So this story takes place August 5th, 1949. This is in Montana. It's a wildfire that burned nearly 5,000 acres of woods and wild grass. It was an ordinary ground fire at the time, and the people sent in to fight this were smoke jumpers, an elite group of firefighters. They'd been around for about 9 years at this point. There were 15, and they were confident that they would quickly have this fire out. The U.S. Forest Service would send them in. They would parachute out of a plane, and they had quite a reputation of being daring. They would jump out. There's pictures of them like wearing like face masks and other things because they don't just parachute out into a nice landing. They parachute into trees, onto rocks, all sorts of things. These guys are tough. And so they jumped out of a C-47, Miss Montana. What a great name for a plane. And so they jumped out of Miss Montana, these 15 guys. They parachute down, and a relatively uneventful landing. They collected their things, and they met another fire guard on the ground. So there's 16 of them at this point. At 5 o'clock, they were ready to move, and they weren't overly alarmed. The fire had grown, but it didn't seem dangerous, that any more dangerous than what they usually faced. As they kept going, their foreman didn't like how things looked. The fire was taking a strange turn, and so they changed their course, and they started going another direction. By 5:45, they were not just on an escape route, they started running. They were desperate at this point. The flames were about 30 feet high. The crew was on a steep, steep slope. About 700 yards to run through a rock cleft. By 5:57 p.m., 13 perished. 2 made the run. 1 found a place of safety. A tragedy. A horrible tragedy. And wonder, well, what could have happened that had this all come together? And it was a number of small decisions that added up. One of the key pieces was that they didn't drop their tools. They didn't drop their tools. So let's slow down the story a little bit and think about this a little bit more. When the fire first started, it was spotted at about a 6-acre fire. When they jumped, it was about 60 acres. When they landed, they thought their primary job was fire control, not safety of the crew. That was bad decision number 1. The focus was only on the task, not people. The crew started running late. The crew foreman didn't give the command to drop their tools until really late. Most tragic, a number of them would never drop their tools, even though there's a fire over 1,000 degrees at their heels, where every second counts. You wonder, why would they do this? Let's think about this. Cindy saw me bringing this, and she said, "You're not starting that today." That's a good idea. I would, no. Okay, we digress. Think about this. I mean, this is a lightweight chainsaw. 1949 chainsaws were not like this. Not everybody was carrying a chainsaw, but they all had heavy tools. You think, why would they keep running with something like this? Why would they keep running with the weight? Because they were fighting a fire. They weren't seeking safety. Their identity was that they were going to put this fire out. Their identity rested on getting the fire put out. They weren't going to drop what it took to put the fire out. They were going to keep going no matter what the cost was. They saw this as a win-lose situation. They put the fire out and they win because they are still the elite firefighters. If they drop their tools and run, they lose because their identity gets shaken. Think about how this is true of human nature. How many things do we face as win-lose, in which we're not going to drop certain things? We're going to keep going. We're going to keep fighting until the end, no matter what. Now let's think about Diotrephes. Is he really that bad of a guy? Or is he so focused on his identity, he wants to be a leader? He wants to be the leader of this church. And John's irritating because he's got more authority, and it's bothersome. He's not focused on the kingdom. He's focused on his own identity. He's still carrying his heavy tools rather than seeing the larger purpose. This fire, I think, connects with us. How often are we so focused on looking like a winner that we don't drop our tools? That we'll make choices and decisions at a high cost to other people so we can get what we think is needed because of our identity? We'll come back to this. Diotrephes is an important example in which he desperately needs introspection and to listen to those around him. But then there's Gaius. I think that we can relate to Gaius. He's the good guy in this story in which he's the guy that's doing some good things. And John says, you know, there's problems you need to address. You know how we respond to problems, how I respond to problems sometimes? Sam is going to help me with this because it's a family trait. Sam, come on up. In which we're going to take you back to Sam's childhood. All right, for those of you who have spent a week with Sam, you're going to see Sam revert to his childhood. Maybe you saw that all this week. I don't know. Okay, so Sam, to help us remember your childhood, for a number of years you had your own language. Could you share with us some of your own language? Could you take us back to your early years?
Ask me to tell a story.
Oh, Sam, tell us a story about your Tonka truck. That was all the words that Sam used for the first 20 years of his life. Wait, you're only 17. Okay, all right. So Sam, that was Sam's vocabulary for a lot when he was young. Another interesting thing that he did when he was young was that he would take care of a lot of problems. So Sam, why don't you turn around? And so if Sam was, say, younger, we won't put an age on it, and well done, if Sam was in a setting like this, he would not like it. Sam was not the social butterfly that he is today. In which, if he turned around and saw you, this is what it would look like. He would close his eyes, but magically you'd all disappear. It was amazing. He would just pretend, like people would talk to him, and he would just be like, meh. He was in his own world. Did he do that this week? All right, thank you. Thank you, Sam. Proud of my family. When there's problems, when there's hard things, we quite often close our eyes, right? We'll say, it doesn't really affect me. Now, let's think about this story. Let's think about how Gaius could have written this situation off a little bit. You know, so Diotrephes was talking wicked nonsense against us. All right, so he gossiped. All right, not so good. He refuses to welcome the brothers. He's a little prickly, right? He's sort of like that prickly ant. You know, it's just the way it goes. And then the part about he stops those and puts them out of the church, he's hard to get along with. We all know people who are hard to get along with. And so it's easy to close our eyes and just kind of write it off. But what John says is the focus is he's thwarting God's will. This is a big deal. Don't just focus on the little pieces of, oh, he's a prickly pear and he's Mr. Grumpy Pants and stuff like that. There's something bigger at issue. It's God's will. But notice what Gaius is supposed to do. Gaius isn't supposed to be the instant hero. What Paul tells him in verse 11 is, do not imitate evil, but imitate good. Apply this to yourself first. We get the sense that Gaius is going to join John in dealing with this problem. But the first step is imitate good, don't imitate evil. Kind of a simple formula here. But what he's saying is, don't close your eyes. There were no houses and no lives in danger with this wildfire. these men were sent in to fight a fire that wasn't jeopardizing life. They were sent to fight the wrong fight. It wasn't until 1978, well after 1949, that the U.S. Forest Service said, maybe we should let some fires go and run the forest fire cycle. Even though the science was from the 1880s, it took until 1978 to say, it's time to change our policy, especially when life and property is not in danger. When it comes to dealing with hard things, we need to make sure that we focus on the right fight. It would be really easy to tackle Diotrephes with him being a jerk, right? I mean, he's not nice. But instead of going after his personality or going after some personal traits, what John focuses on and telling Gaius is, what is at stake is God's will. What is at stake is the missional work of the church. Make sure you stay focused on the right thing. So this brings us to John. I love thinking about John as the author because there's one more thing. This comes to mind with John. Do you know what this is? Is this ever used anymore? Kind of? I've never used one. What is it? It's an iron. Yes. It's not iron. John Iron. All right. Good to see you. Was I going somewhere with this? It doesn't get any better. So welcome into Carl's world of word association. Iron. Iron E. Get it? Iron. Iron E. See where this is going? Groan. Groan while you can. Oh, come on, Kevin. Come on. Give me $200 and I'll put it away. Think about the irony of John writing this letter. Think about this together. John pens these inspired words. Diotrephes, who likes to put himself first. Think about this. John and his brother had their mommy ask Jesus to give them the best seats in heaven. And John, now in later life, is writing a story and saying, Diotrephes likes to put himself first. Yes, yes, irony. Irony, and this is not a standalone incident. Think about John's life. So there's the story in Matthew, but remember when Jesus first called him, as recorded in Mark 3, he and his brother called Sons of Thunder. You know, the name of a wrestling team pretty much, right? I mean, these guys have something going on. These are the ones who are going to help Jesus out when a Samaritan village doesn't take Jesus in very well. They say, hey, Jesus, how about we call down fire from heaven and burn up this village? Nice guys, right? Does this sound like nice guys? John knows something about putting himself first. The difference is he listened to Jesus. Remember in the Gospel of John? What's recorded is the disciple whom Jesus loved reclining on Jesus, a nearness to Jesus. There are some messy things in John's life in which he clearly is putting himself first, but he learned from these because he stayed close to Jesus, he listened, and now he's sharing this, he's communicating this with Gaius and Diotrephes. There are some things for us to learn here. There's importance with communication. I want to go back to the Man Gulch fire again with the importance of communication. I said in the story that two escaped because they ran fast enough and happened to get the right course to get out of the way of the fire. One found a place of safety. This was the crew chief, Wagner Dodge. Here was his place of safety. He got to a place in the middle of some grass. He lit a match, threw it in the grass, burned a spot, beckoned the other people to join him in his little fire, and he put a wet handkerchief over his mouth and he laid down. And the rest of the crew said, "The guy's crazy." No one was doing an escape fire at this point. And they're trained for forest fires. At this point, they're not in a forest. They're in grass. Everything is different. They didn't see it. Wagner Dodge caught it. He caught the change of context. And he made this escape fire, and that is where he survived. After the fire passed over, he stood back up unscathed. Now, why didn't everyone else join him in this place? It came down to communication. Now, let's think about what's happening. For Wagner Dodge, he didn't share just cause of why they should do this. He wasn't sharing with them, "Hey, look how everything has changed. Look how we're no longer in the woods. The wind's not protected by the trees. We're out in the open. Let's do something different." He didn't say anything along those lines, and once they got into the heat of the moment, the rush of the fire, the sound, think about the sound of a fire that's 1,500 to 1,800 degrees Fahrenheit. It's burning 3,000 acres in 10 minutes. It's not the greatest time to communicate at that point, but the communication didn't happen before. The just cause wasn't given. And there was a lack of trust. These guys never trained together. They're pretty much assembled quick and sent out and jumped and just assumed that everybody listened to the foreman. When their lives were in jeopardy, they didn't know this guy from anything. They hadn't trained together. Let's think about how John is communicating here. The just cause that John is giving to, here's a situation to deal with. He stays on focus. Think about what he says. He focuses on gossip, inhospitable, and derailing God's mission. He stays focused on the cause of concern, but then he builds trust. If we listen to the whole letter, we hear some important things. There's relationship. He talks about praying. He talks about a personal visit, and he's clearly investing time not just in Gaius, but also Diotrephes. I think John learned something when he was putting himself first consistently. He listened to Jesus, and his life was changed. We get the impression here that he's looking to communicate with Diotrephes as well, that there's still hope. He's looking to communicate in a winsome way. Now let's go back and think again about where this story is going. And let's also pause and find my notes together. All right. You know, there's a danger in putting things on a 3x5 card. You know, you never know, like, did I stick it in a pocket? Did I stick it somewhere in Matthew, in Mark? Where did I put that thing? So let's walk through. A few things that we learn from each of these people. With Diotrephes, we learn our need to be meek. Let's be honest. We always want to be the one who tells other people what they're doing wrong. I'm a parent. I'm gifted at that, right? Oh, yeah. If we are going to be encouraged as encouragers, we need to listen to people that God places in our life. And sometimes that might be hard truth. Diotrephes and Gaius are receiving hard truth here. Are we relationally in a place where we're soaking in hard truth? Who is the truth teller in your life? Honestly, do you have a truth teller in your life that you listen to? If not, Where's Diotrephes in relation to you? To me. Let's think about this in terms of Gaius. Once again, he needs a truth teller, but he's facing a hard thing. Let's be honest. What's the hard thing that you're facing right now? Now, for some of us, it's kind of like, well, which side of the page do you want to choose from? You know, page 6 or page 8? Think about it. What is a hard thing? Honestly, don't close your eyes to it. What is a hard thing that you're facing right now? And that brings us to John. Have we learned from our life lessons before in life? Have we listened to those times where we put ourselves first and Jesus called us out? Are we communicating that well to the people around us? From a place of a posture of humility, not talking down, but talking in a way of, I've lived this also. As we come to the table for Lord's Supper, this passage has tremendous importance for us. For us to be hearing well, we need to be in right relationship, vertically and horizontally, with God and with one another. In 1 John, John's sermon that he wrote, he said this, "That which we have seen and heard, we proclaim also to you, so that you too may have fellowship with us. And indeed, our fellowship is with the Father and with the Son, Jesus Christ." As we come to the table, we're remembering the invitation to fellowship with God, but also an invitation of deeper fellowship with one another. This is the message we have heard from him and proclaimed to you, that God is light, and in him is no darkness at all. If we say we have fellowship with him while we still walk in darkness, we lie and do not practice the truth. But if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus, his Son, cleanses us from all sin. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all righteousness. At this point, I invite you to start the mechanics of, don't drop your tool yet, of opening. Okay, first thing you have to do is you have to hold your tongue out just a little bit. All right, that's good. And then you have to get the top wrapper pulled back. All right? Because we're going to start with the bread. We're going to start with the wafer. So have that ready. And here's what we want to think about as we undertake the laborious task of getting to the bread. We are invited into fellowship with the Father, with the Son, and the Holy Spirit. This is not something to take lightly. We know the forgiveness of sins because Jesus Christ died on the cross and paid the penalty for our sins. He didn't just break the consequences of our sin, he broke the power of sin. We know freedom in Jesus Christ because of his death and resurrection. Hear the words from John one more time. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all righteousness. As we take the bread, specifically ask forgiveness for a sin, something that's distancing us from God. Let's be honest before God and know his forgiveness and the freedom in him. Take and eat and know his forgiveness. as we walked through 3 John today, we talked about the need to be walking with God, but also walking with one another in right relationship with each other. Here are the words from 1 John again that describes the intersection of the forgiveness of Christ and fellowship together. 1 John 1, verse 7. But if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another. And the blood of Jesus, his son, cleanses us from all sin. As we peel back the foil and prepare the cup, I invite you to think about, where's a broken relationship? Where's a relationship that's not where it should be? God restores all things. Let's bring that before him now as we seek true unity, where we seek relationship with one another the way God intends. Take and drink the blood of Christ. Let's pray together. Father, we have participated in the Lord's Supper together. The words that we are reminded of, for I received from the Lord Jesus what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus on the night when he was betrayed took bread, when he had given thanks, he broke it. And then again, in the same way, also the cup after supper, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. Father, may we truly know that forgiveness of sin. May it not just be something that we experience in our minds, but something that we experience in our whole self. Lord, may we know your forgiveness and your restoration, restoration with you and restoration with those that we are distanced from. Lord, may we know your encouragement to do hard things, to stand up against injustice, to stand up against things that are wrong. And Lord, may it begin in our own lives. May we see what's wrong, repent of the sin, and walk in your light. Lord, may we also be honest about what's wrong around us and to imitate good despite that influence. And Lord, may we communicate it well. May we communicate it in winsome ways for the sake of your kingdom, not so we can win. Lord, as we sing about the redeemed, may we truly celebrate being redeemed in community. In Jesus' name, amen.
And I want to invite you all to stand as we sing together. You know what? One of the greatest encouragements you can have is to always know that our God reigns, to know our position in him, and to know, you know, the bridge of this song, all the powers of darkness tremble at what they've just heard, because all the powers of darkness can't drown out a single word. Let that be encouragement, and let's sing this out today. It's the song of the redeemed, rising from the African plain. It's the song of the forgiven, drowning out the Amazon rain. The song of Asian believers, filled with God's holy fire. Every tongue, every nation, a love song born of a grateful choir. It's all God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah, he reigns, he reigns. It's all God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah, he reigns. So let it rise above the four winds,
caught up in the heavenly sound. Let praises echo from the towers of cathedrals to the faithful gathered underground. Of all the songs sung from the dawn of creation, some were meant to persist. Of all the bells rung from a thousand steeples, none rings truer than this. It's all God's children singing, glory, glory, hallelujah, he reigns, he reigns. It's all God's children singing, glory, glory, hallelujah, he reigns. It's all God's children singing, glory, glory, hallelujah, he reigns, he reigns. It's all God's children singing, glory, glory, hallelujah, he reigns. And all the powers of darkness tremble at what they've just heard. 'Cause all the powers of darkness can't drown out a single word. When all God's children sing, glory, glory, hallelujah, he reigns, he reigns. All God's children singing, glory, glory, hallelujah, he reigns. So all God's children sing, glory, glory, hallelujah, he reigns. All God's children sing out, glory, glory, hallelujah, he reigns.
At the end of the worship service, Pastor Nate says, I love you. Jesus Christ loves you. I got the order wrong. He does it better. Receive that encouraging word. We are together here knowing that Jesus Christ loves us and our covenant community loves one another. Let's close remembering the encouraging words that John gives. For I rejoiced greatly when the brothers came and testified to your truth, as indeed you are walking in the truth. I have no greater joy than to hear that my children are walking in the truth. May we encourage one another to walk in the truth and know his joy. Amen. Enjoy a great Sabbath day.